Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm Elizabeth Sackler, and it is indeed a pleasure for me as founder of the Sackler Center and also as the current chair of the Brooklyn Museum to be hosting States of Denial, the Illegal Incarceration of Women, Children, and People of Color. Thank you. Thank you. That first clap was Susan Rosenberg, and Susan Rosenberg came here and did a wonderful discussion. And if you want to see it, you can, and all of the programming we've done, this is our 14th, www.brooklynmuseum.org/EASCFA/video. Susan Rosenberg just came up to me. For those of you, well, most of you probably know, but for those of you who don't, Susan Rosenberg was a political prisoner and was incarcerated for 17 years. She received clemency in 2001, and she just came up to me and she said, "Thank you for kicking ass again." And I said, at this point, it's gonna take a hell of a lot more than kicking ass to get out of where we are. So with that, though, I would like to acknowledge that Sackler Center, if you would stand up, please, do you mind? Seven years incarcerated, original Black Panther, Panther 21, our hero. The 2015 and 2016 programming for States of Denial is made possible by the Novo Foundation. And we have had this year already a series called Touching Humanity, Creativity, and Transformation. We had Max Kenner came and spoke on reflections on 10 years of the Barred Prison Initiative. And Mothers of Bedford came, and we had a film screening and discussion. Just last weekend, Brian Stevenson was here with Anthony Ray Hinton, and it was a glorious and moving and upsetting and thrilling opportunity to hear the two of them. As many of you know, of course, Brian's work with the EJI is absolutely essential. I want to thank Novo for having supported this series, thank Pamela Schiffman, who is the executive director of Novo, and to thank Jacinia Santana, who is the program officer of Novo's initiative to end violence against girls and women. So thank them, yeah. Yeah, we have to. We have to remember who is with us. During this week, I was thinking a lot about how to introduce today. And the first thing I need to tell you is that on June 2nd, the Sackler Center First Awards are honoring Angela Davis. And she will be here, feminist scholar activist for social justice. There will be a film. There will be the First Lady of New York City. There will be Angela in discussion with Gloria Steinem, and I'm sure it is going to be a very, very special occasion, so I hope that you can join us. In thinking about this, and thinking about what it is to be concluding our second year, we began States of Denial in 2014. As I was thinking about it, I got hit with this truth, and it sort of came down on me that I've been doing this here at the Brooklyn Museum for 2 years, but there are entire populations in this country who have known all about this and more for multiple decades. Prison loss of children, unchecked abuse of prison guards, and police officers. In fact, people have known about this for 200 years, and of course the First Peoples for 500 years. To people who say that the system is broken, I can't say criminal justice in the same, it doesn't make sense to me. So to say that our prison system is broken. I say no. This system was conceived and built and functions exactly as it was intended. To criminalize and send away people of color, to disenfranchise entire segments of our population, of our country people, of our sisters and brothers, and to tear apart the fabric of family and community, and to render a people mute. And I am sorry to say it has been so successful that we have a lot of fighting to do. If in 1971 you happened to be aware, Angela Davis wrote, edited, "If They Come For You in the Morning, Voices of Resistance," and it was published, that very book. She edited it with Bettina Aptheker and other members of the National United Committee to Free Angela Davis and All Political Prisoners. The book begins with an open letter. It's an open letter to my sister, Angela Y. Davis, by James Baldwin. It's 5 pages long, but it ends thus. Quote, "The enormous revolution in black consciousness which has occurred in your generation, my dear sister, means the beginning of the end of America. Some of us, white and black, know how great a price has already been paid to bring into existence a new consciousness, a new people, an unprecedented nation. If we know and do nothing, we are worse than the murderers hired in our name. If we know, then we must fight for your life as though it were our own, which it is, and render impassable with our bodies the corridor to the gas chamber. For if they take you in the morning, they will be coming for us that night. Therefore, peace." Signed, Brother James, November 19, 1970. Things were covert, things are now overt, and things are not going to get any better, things are going to get worse, and so we have to act to change, and that will not be easy. We have to act fiercely. The meaning of our lives must be recognized as inextricable from human relationships and moral values. If we relinquish that, we have relinquished our humanity. And Kathleen Cleaver, welcome. Please stand up. She came in right on cue. Today, I want to thank our panelists, Kathleen Cleaver, Monica Dennis, Jamal Joseph, Carmen Perez, Laura Whitehorn, we Twitter back and forth, Laura and I, for your bad values and for your action over all of these many decades and our new generation coming up to help lead the way. And I thank, of course, today's moderator, my sister, and the extraordinary executive director of the Correctional Association of New York, Soffiyah Elijah, for the culture of social care. Soffiyah, and we can applaud one more time because she is receiving the 2016 Lawyer for the People Award from the National Lawyers Guild, New York City in August. Please join me in welcoming Soffiyah Elijah. It's all yours, baby. Thank you all for being here today. Lovely to be here. Okay, you're so welcome.
Well, good afternoon. I am really, really tickled to be here. That's a real professional term, right? Okay. I really appreciate you all coming to spend this afternoon with us. We're going to take up a very serious topic. And we're going to talk about the role of culture in social change. But I want, before we move into that topic and bring our guests up, I'd be remiss if I didn't give a shout out to the role of cultural institutions in cultural change and social change. And let's start with the Brooklyn Museum where we are right now. You know, I am a criminal defense lawyer by training, and we always start with the large and then we go down to the specific. So now let's talk about the specific, because we are at the Elizabeth A. Sackler Center for Feminist Art, and that is the entity that is put on states of denial. So let's clap it up for them. I want to acknowledge a very special person in the audience, and there are a lot of special people in the audience, like all of you, but there one person in particular who I want to shout out, and it's not someone that I've known for a long time, and there are many of you in the audience who I have known for a long time, but there's someone in the audience who I met very recently, who journeyed to our office up at 125th Street and Adam Clayton Powell Boulevard a few weeks ago. And we had the most amazing conversation. As many of you know, the work of the Correctional Association is multifaceted. But one of our focuses is on the issue of violence and abuse inside the prison system here in New York State, with a particular focus in calling for the shutdown of Attica. Not because Attica is the only problematic prison, and I assume many of you read today's Daily News article that focused on Southport and the horrors there, and we could go on and on and on. But our campaign calls for the shutdown of Attica, and the gentleman who came to see me spent 20 years in Attica for a crime he did not commit. And he went in when he was 18 years old, and that's Antonio Yarbrough, and I'm going to ask him to stand up. Mr. Yarbrough was the first of the many exonerees under the Brooklyn DA's wrongful conviction review project. And it was just amazing that he is now able to join us. And he came to see me to say, I am dedicating myself to help the Correctional Association in your efforts to expose the violence and abuse inside this system. Thank you, Antonio. Okay, without further ado, I'm going to ask my wonderful panelists to come up. Kathleen, Monica, Carmen, Jamal, Laura. As they said, let's give the people what they want. Okay. Okay, I think I'm going to open it up with a pretty general question. And, you know, in my life, I try to do everything from the left perspective, so we'll start from my left. Okay. So the question is, and we'll just go around, which is why, starting with you, Jamal, why do you commit your life to this work? That's a pretty broad question, but in just a couple of minutes. Why do you commit your life to this work? Why is it important to you?
It's important because if we don't use arts for information and radical transformation, we will be overtaken by a tsunami of disinformation, psychological and physical oppression, colonization, all the things that you can think of that happens if there's no antidote to the poison, racism, fascism, the militarization of the and all the things that are happening. And so it became clear to me, we'll talk about this a little more, I'm sure, that when I walked into the Panther office at 15, how important art and radical transformation were, how important it was for us to tell our own stories. I'll tell a story really quickly. I guess I first became aware of it even before the Panthers. It was a simple truth that kind of happened in a moment with my grandfather. And I was doing my homework by the TV. The only way I could get away with that is because he was watching TV. And to understand that his parents and older brothers and sisters had been slaves. So he knew about lynching, brutality, Jim Crow, all of that firsthand. He had done everything. He had been a merchant marine. He had been a taxi driver. He had been a prize fighter. But above all, he was something that we call back in those days a race man. He had been a Garveyite. But he was retired, and he could cuss like a sailor. And a Tarzan movie was playing on TV. Johnny Weissmuller was swinging across the screen. He did the Tarzan yell. And there were white hunters with guns, and they had the guns on the damsel in distress. And the Africans are standing on the side, and we now know many of them weren't even Africans. They were actors in black body paint, looking stupid and ignorant and afraid. And Tarzan does his Tarzan speak, and lions come, and elephants come, and they save it. And Grandpa's just sitting there looking at this, and this was his critique. After about 3 minutes, he goes, "Now what the fuck is that?" He said, "Boy, tell me how in the hell a little peckerwood baby fall out the damn plane. He run in the jungle, he speak lion, monkey, everything. I can look like they're crazy. Change the damn channel." First cultural critique. Then we turn to Harry Reid, a young Harry Reisner who was doing what I later came to know was an editorial. And he was talking about the race for space. Back then, the big thing was that the Russians had beat us into space and what was going to happen if we didn't. And he gave Mr. Reisner maybe 3 minutes. And here was his critique. "Use a frying pan face, onion head, lion, motherfucking cracker, change the channel." And at that early age, I knew not to trust just everything that was fed to me. And I think that is the basic reason we can't trust everything that's fed to us.
Now, that is what I call a personal response. Okay. Kathleen. Why is this so important to you? Why do you commit your life to this work?
I was kind of born into it. My parents were civil rights activists, challenging segregation, going to court. My father worked in the challenging the all-white primary in Texas before I was born. And when I was born in Texas, it was probably one of the most racist places in America. My very, very first memory, really, literally, my very first memory in the world is of being stopped by the police in my parents' car. They were speeding to get to the hospital because my brother was sick. So I just thought that's bizarre. The very first thing I remember is police. But that was the South. Why do I do it? Because growing up in Texas and Alabama and other parts of the South, the racial domination was so intense. And my parents were activists. They were college educated, they were teachers, and they were part of a movement in Tuskegee, the same movement that you've heard about, the Montgomery Improvement Association. Well, in Tuskegee, we had the Tuskegee Civic Association, and we worked together. So I grew up in the civil rights movement, and it seemed to be the most important thing to do, and I never changed that attitude.
Okay, now we've heard from two. Thank you. Two veterans. Now we're going to hear from some more recent activists. Monica Dennis, why do you commit your life to this?
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Monica Dennis. I have the privilege of organizing with Black Lives Matter here in New York City. But I do this work. I'm a seventh generation African born in the US, which means I have no idea where my people are from. I know where they're trafficked from. And that frame has has centered everything that, I do, to be engaging with the state from the time that my family was brought here, engaging with the state in terms of carceral violence, reproductive violence, mental health violence, and the ways in which racial terror was actually, my family had to always be responding to the racial terrorism that was happening in their daily lives. So organizing is the way that my family did that. So I come to this work out of actual need to stay alive. And I continue to do this work because, as a person that's literally the first person in my family that's born, in my mother's line, that's born outside of a rural context, that's born in a city, the dynamics are not very different than what they experienced. And so I come because I need to have my humanity restored every day. So that's the approach I take to organizing, because I believe in liberation, and because I want to see all peoples that have been marginalized by this work free, and I want to do it in community, and I want to do it in ways that are restorative. And so the way that I see people organizing here and across the country is why I do this work. So I have a long history organizing, but at the core, it's just to maintain my own humanity, my own dignity, and the dignity of those in my community. Okay.
I'm just going to tell you now, because otherwise Monica's going to be worried the entire time that I'm going to share this. I'll just get it out of the way. So Monica and I probably known each other longer than I've known anybody else on this stage, because her uncle was my first boyfriend in college. So we keep it tight. Okay? Okay, Carmen, why do you commit yourself to this work?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Carmen Perez. I'm the executive director of the Gathering for Justice and the co-founder of Justice League NYC. And for me, I feel as a very young person, I grew up outside of Los Angeles in a city or town by the name of Oxnard, California. And I grew up in a very diverse community. My best friends were Black, Korean, Filipino, white. We were really a conglomerate. We were the United Nations. And our culture was hip hop and basketball. There was definitely within my own family, 7 generations of gang membership. Later on, at the age of 17, I lost a sister who was buried on my 17th birthday. Her and I were a day apart. But I also had an older brother who's 14 years older than me, in and out the system. And so at an early age, I learned how to bail my oldest brother out and be Mrs. Perez. And so criminal injustice working within the system has been something I've dedicated my life to. It's not something that I went to college for. I studied psychology for self-healing, but it was because I really saw the young people that were being impacted by incarceration as myself. Those young people were actually me and my friends. They were the people that needed some guidance and some opportunity. And luckily for me, I had basketball. And I had a family that I created outside of my nuclear family where there was domestic violence. And so for me, it was creating my own identity, but also really tapping into what I was born to do. I know that my father's 92 years old, my mother's 72, and recently I've kind of changed the way in which I say things. I usually say I'm their oh shit baby. Like, oh shit, what? Like, we having a baby? I'm in my 50s, how can that happen? But I'm really a miracle baby. I know that I was brought in. I was born to do this work and to dedicate my life to the liberation of our people, poor Black brown people. And I also see my liberation bound in the liberation of Black folks, particularly because when Black folks are free, I know that my people will be free. And so very similar to my sister, California has always oppressed Mexicans. We've also been lynched. My father was deported under Operation Wetback in the 1940s. My father was born in 1924, and generations and generations of California, he didn't cross the border crossed him. And so I do know that it is my responsibility as an educated woman, as a person who made it out my neighborhood, to go back and reach back and remind those that are hopeless to have hope and create the opportunities and the path for them.
All right. right, Laura, you are, like Jamal and Kathleen, a veteran organizer up here. Why do you commit your life to this work?
So I think we just heard all the reasons why I do. I want to follow Jamal's leadership and start with one little story and then say my main reason I do this work. And that was when I was in, I think, I don't know, sixth grade or something. It was the 50s. And there was a song that we had to sing. I love the United States of America. I love the way we all live without fear. And I had just been learning about the civil rights movement and what was going on in the South. And also, relatives of ours had lost their jobs in the school system because they were communists. So I turned to my best friend and I said, I hate this song, it's a total lie. And the music teacher called me a communist, so then I had to go home and say, I didn't know at that point what a communist was, I had to go home and ask. So I thought, these are all lies that they're telling us, so like Jamal said. But the main reason I do it, I guess I was really organized by the Panthers, thrown into a different kind of sense of things. And I want to bring our comrade, late sister Marilyn Buck, into the room, who was, we did time in prison together, Susan, Marilyn, and I. And Marilyn always said, you need a vision. We can't fight without having a vision. And I think if we're going to talk about culture, that's one of the things, is that what makes me feel whole when I read the newspaper every day and I see what our government is doing here and around the world is that vision of transformation that you talked about. And the last reason is, as a white person, gives me a chance to be a human being instead of a white person and to do something about the fact that I see all the time, and in prison it was true too. In prison, as a white person, when I was, the first 3 years I was locked up, I was in DC jail, Baltimore City jail. Even though the guards had power over me, supposedly, socially, I had more power than they did in the society as a white person. And those contradictions are something that kind of drive me crazy. And if I didn't do this work, I'd probably be crazier than I am. So it gives me a chance to try to be a human being and learn all the time in a different way and hope that we can have a society that we'd want to live in one day.
Yeah, we are experiencing a very interesting dynamic. We've lived, four of us, have lived long enough to see this change. And that change that I'm talking about is, in the 60s and 70s, I think we would pretty much agree that media outlets, mainstream media outlets, were generally adversarial to the movements and the causes that we represented. And now, we're experiencing something a little bit different. So first I want to talk with Laura, Jamal, and Kathleen. How did you, back then, basically circumvent those adversarial media responses and provide a way for the masses to know and understand the issues that you were focused on? And I'm going to start with you, Laura, this time.
Well, when I was in Weatherman, in the beginning, the first thing we did every day was go out with a stack of Black Panther papers and sell them. And we said, you want to know what's going on, you want to know the truth, and these are the people who are making change, and this is what we have to do. And we had to sell our papers. I know you've talked about this too. We had our quota, and we had to sell our papers, and we had to talk to people, and we had to talk to white people, because we were brought up by the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee that had said to us, if white people want to do something about racism, be like John Brown, do something in your own community, and do something to the state while you're at it. So that was one thing. The other thing that we did was we took over TV stations. During the war in Vietnam, we took over TV stations and held up signs and interrupted broadcasts. We did a lot of running off of leaflets. You were talking about Attica before. When the Attica Rebellion happened, some of us moved up to Buffalo for a while to work on the Attica brothers' case and make sure that they weren't going to, on top of having many of their comrades murdered by the state, they also weren't going to end up doing a lot of time in prison. And what did we do there? We mimeographed flyers.
You might have to explain to some people in the audience what a mimeograph is.
What a mimeograph is.
We may have lost a few people.
If you explain to me what Instagram is, I'll explain to you what a mimeograph is.
I got you.
I got you.
And we did something else that was really radical, which is we talked to people, you know, which we, right? I mean, we organized. We were out there talking to people 24 hours a day, which is why I still have a sore throat today. But those were some of the things. I don't know if I agree that the media now is so much more. I mean, we've got...
We're going to get to that.
We'll get to that. But anyway, those were some of the things that we did. And posters. I mean, you showed some of the posters. We can talk later about the graphics that we did that were trying to convey what was going on that was invisible if you only looked at the major media.
Kathleen?
Well, I happen to have become, because I sent out a press release to announce the fact that the Panther Party, which was a very small organization, was having a demonstration outside the Alameda County Courthouse on the day of Huey Newton's appearance in court to be arraigned for murdering an Oakland policeman.
Kathleen.
I had to send out a press release to announce to the press that Huey Newton was going to be in court and the Black Panther Party was holding a protest demonstration outside the courthouse. And this is maybe 2 or 3 weeks after he'd been arrested. The policeman had died. He had survived a shooting incident in Oakland. Now, this is 1966, '67. Every time you turn around, there was a story in the newspaper about a policeman killing a black person, usually a young man, and it was justifiable homicide. This is a regular staple of the news. This story was white policeman killed by the Minister of Defense of the Black Panther Party for self-defense. That was not the normal news. It was amazing, and so, we planned a demonstration, but to get out the demonstration, we created leaflets, we created press releases. The Black Panther Party was essentially in collapse at that time, but as we held these demonstrations going to court, we revived, we put out flyers, we put out posters. We didn't have any budget. We didn't have much of a treasury by then at that time. And so everything we did was either created or donated, and so it was the culture, the images, the drawings of Emory Douglas, I made posters, other people made posters, the circling the courthouse, the berets, the creating the images of protest and struggle that we could do as teenagers and young people in Oakland. And that had a cultural impact. To this day, it has a cultural impact. I don't know if we understood that. What we understood was we had to save Huey's life. And we really didn't have the resources, particularly because he was going to go to trial as the defense minister of the Black Panther Party for self-defense in an incident in which a very well-known Oakland policeman who was fairly brutal was killed. So from that start, the Black Panther Party began to generate its message and convey what we believed through images, through drawings, through songs, through protests, through the way we dressed, the things that we could actually control. We didn't have access, although we tried to get to it, to the television, and then we'd hold press conferences and we'd be on television. But really, it was a popular medium, and it was popular protest that attracted a huge amount of attention, particularly from young people. When I say young people, I mean all the way down to little children in the street. I knew we had caught on when I heard little boys in the neighborhood where I lived in San Francisco. They didn't play cops and robbers. They didn't play cowboys and Indians. They played panthers and pigs.
Okay, Jamal, how do you follow that?
So I think what we understood was that is that if the media wasn't going to cover us, we would cover ourselves. And I think we understood that we were making the news that people would relate to because we were doing things in the community that people understood. So the images, and we caught lightning in a bottle maybe without realizing that we had done it, but in the same way that hip-hop did, because our fingers were right on the pulse in terms of what was happening. Even the Panther uniform was something that that everybody had in their closet. Everybody had a black leather coat, and you can get the beret. And this image of what was going on in the community, people would read the paper or look at the short films that were coming out, and it would say, that's me right there. I'm seeing myself. That's my story. Nobody is telling that story. So we didn't wait for permission. And a lot of times people are waiting for permission to do a program. My wife Joyce reminded me of this when we started a youth program called Impact Repertory Theater. And I was worried about funding, where would we be? She said, how did the Panthers start the breakfast program? And she reminded me that we saw a need, that kids were hungry, that there was this fallacy that kids are disrupted in school and black students don't do well. And we realized that maybe the problem is in first grade that if a teacher is telling you that 3 apples plus 2 apples equal 5 apples and your stomach is growling because you didn't have breakfast and barely had dinner the night before, it's hard to concentrate and learn. And so we went out and got donations, got spaces, and started feeding kids, not waiting for RFP, not waiting for permission. We knew that that had to be done. And so that was what the Panther newspaper was about. And that was what about this thing that we used to call in the party, creating a colossal event. We'd create an event, right? We'd say we'd want to bring attention on something and create an event that we knew that would get coverage in a way that couldn't be ignored and that we could interpret it in the community, because it wasn't just going to be a voice on the radio. It wasn't just going to be someone that you saw on TV that was a disembodiment kind of voice of God telling you to use. Panthers were out on the corner selling these papers, showing people images of what was happening, and each Panther had learned to be able to kind of express themselves. So when you came into the Panther office, you know, my first trainer and mentor and section leader was Sekou Odinga. And I was an honor student, and Sekou asked me, what can you do? You know, I came and think I was going to get a gun that first day, but Sekou asked me, what can you do? And I said, well, I'm an honor student. He says, that means you could write then, right? He was like, go out and cover what's happening with this rent strike and these school takeover and put my skills to work. And so that is the idea. The idea is not waiting for permission to be bold and audacious and innovative and let people see themselves, and they will respond to those images.
Your mention of Marilyn reminded me. Marilyn Buck was in, what was that group in the Bay Area?
Oh, Third World Newsreel.
Yeah. Third World Newsreel. And they made films. Now, how did they make films? Third World Newsreel didn't really have any money. They had the collaboration of off-duty television cameramen who would bring their big, huge cameras that you carried around on your shoulders back then, cover our events. Marilyn and some other people in the Bay Area would edit them, and we'd make these little short films. One of the best ones, my favorite film actually, is called Black Panther. It's about 15 minutes long. And we had the ability to generate attraction, generate information by showing these basically home movies of the Black Panther Party, and that intrigued others. And so filmmakers and photographers were gravitating towards us, and so the images that we could generate became very widespread in Northern California through Ramparts magazine and through other newspapers and through the Black Panther newspaper. So the visual impact of what we were doing was distributed very widely, and it attracted more and more people. So every time we'd have a demonstration, we get more people, and then we get more coverage, until essentially the Huey Newton trial became not only a phenomenon, but it became the engine of rebuilding the Black Panther Party in the Bay Area and then across California. And Eldridge Cleaver, who was an ex-convict on parole at the time Huey Newton was shot, said to me, we were engaged at that time, he said, well, it's more important to me to make sure that Huey lives than for me to stay off parole. So he just basically threw caution to the winds and became openly, while on parole from California State Prison, openly the Minister of Defense of the Black Panther Party, which did end up getting him arrested again. But so we had this tremendous appeal through popular media, things that people hadn't seen, and doing things people had never seen before. And they were, I just remember the first demonstration, not demonstration, the first time we were rallying for the demonstration, David Hilliard and I were in a flatbed truck in the Bay Area, in Oakland, and we played Junior Wilson's shotgun, attract attention. And they said, come down to the courthouse, see about Huey Newton. They said, well, he's going to get killed. And I was like, he's going to the gas chamber. I said, not if you come down and support us. So we had this energy that was a cultural energy because it was basic, it was real, it was about things that everybody knew, but no one had ever seen an arrested black man being treated in this way by people in his organization. So we changed things from day one.
Quick story. A friend of mine reminded me, we got into our Panther uniforms, and it was our first time we were dressed up as Panthers, and we couldn't get anybody to take the picture. And he says, you remember that picture? And he says, yeah. He says, remember we held that Polaroid out and took that Panther photo? He says, yeah. He said, you know we took the first selfie, right, brother? Power to the people.
So, a Polaroid selfie, I can't, that's not a good look. You know, as I was listening to you talk about Third World Newsreel and the efforts that Maryland engaged in, it reminded me of Maryland telling me how they would take some of that footage and they would go into poorest communities that they could find and they would literally project those films on the sides of buildings in the poorest neighborhoods to educate people about what was going on and to try to mobilize them. So we're not doing those things now. We've got social media and we've got other... We're going to learn about Instagram together, Laura. So, Carmen, I want to turn to you. How are you using the available media outlets today to organize? And I'm going to put the same question to you, Monica.
So, I think media is still very unreliable. And because what we see currently in the media, very similar to, you know, what happened in the past, is an assassination of character and individuals, particularly around the Central Park Five, Jenna Six, but also in regards to the victims of police brutality, the way in which they're portrayed in the media, the way in which they are criminalized, and then you have those that are doing mass shootings, and it looks as though they're saints. So what we've done is we've taken we've taken a spin as to how we utilize social media. We use Twitter, Periscope, so that we could own the narrative and we could release information as it pertains to real time. And I think that's the difference between back in the day. We also still knock on doors and organize and have the face-to-face, but it's also really important to make sure that when we are live somewhere that we are actually telling the story in real time so that it does not get co-opted by mainstream media that then shifts the narrative. And I know that for us, we have people like Roland Martin that are our allies, Melissa Harris-Perry, but then again, we're seeing that people like them are also, their segments are being taken away based on what the way in which black and brown people are portrayed in this country. And so for us, you know, we use Periscope. I see my sister right here, Lindsay, using Periscope, providing this audience and an outer audience the opportunity to be here in real time. And I think that's what's really important about all the different avenues. But I will say that there are paid provocateurs that do pit people against one another on Twitter. And we've seen that currently in the Black Lives Matter movement. The fact we were talking about COINTELPRO back in the day where you could see the person that was coming into the meeting and you could tell that those individuals were the ones that were part of the FBI and the CIA or whatever. Mr. Belafonte always talks about his therapist being one of those individuals. But for us, it's also knowing that it looks different now. There are individuals that are coming in and trying to shift the narrative. There are groups that will attack some of us that are using different tactics, but it's our responsibility to constantly share our story and tell and own our own narrative.
Thank you. Monica.
I agree. I completely agree with Carmen and others who are, we know the mainstream media is hostile in this current moment and it is dependent upon that hostility to continue to incarcerate us, to continue to murder us and continue to enslave us mentally and physically. And so what excites me about the current way in which we're using culture is that we're actually tapping into indigenous and traditional ways that black people have used culture, right? And so it brings forward and it doesn't leave behind the history of people that have come before us because Carmen and I were talking about the real energy around pitting generations against each other in terms of movement building, and that is a strategic tactic of white supremacy. If you can separate me from my elders and the wisdom and the knowledge and the technique and the culture and the history, then I have to figure it out for myself. and then I think I did this on my own, and that is not the case. So what I love about the way that we're using culture is I have to depend and I have to go back to the history of people that have come before me. We see things like the Free Black Women's Library here in Brooklyn and now in Chicago as a tactic to organize folks, where black women here, a woman named Ola Ronke is using takes her bicycle around community and actually gives books out about black women and collects those and is using it to politicize. So again, telling our stories, the controlling of the narrative, the way in which black Twitter can get people together very quickly is extremely effective. And by that I mean the accelerated pace at which we can change a dynamic. So if something is happening, not only are we seeing it in real time, but the response, the way that, again, black Twitter as its own culture responds and requires a particular demand is extremely effective. And then what people would like to reduce to hashtags actually become cultural icons in a sense, or cultural pinning. So if you could have things like Say Her Name, reminding people not only to know the history of who's being murdered, but also like we have to include women in this. So there's like so many things that are working on a level around culture that is actually tapping into the way black people use language, the way we use networking, the way that we connect with each other, the way that we use imagery. And I feel that this platform allows us to just advance that a lot quicker.
And I just want to add, also using, Mr. Belafonte always refers to Paul Robeson as artists being the gatekeepers to truth. And so a lot of the work that we do has been around, you know, imagery and Instagram. We do use Instagram to like get a lot of our flyer, our events out. But we
tell Laura what Instagram is.
Instagram, yeah. We'll have an off-the-record conversation. Yeah. But even the I Can't Breathe t-shirts, we developed those overnight in my apartment. It was like 3 a.m. And one of the things that we were doing is that we were talking to my girl Dream, who was connected to Jay-Z. And I was saying, hey, we want to drop a banner. We want to do a dine in the court. She's like, girl, you're out of your mind. You can't be doing a dine in the middle of the court during a basketball game. And so then we decided to think about something different. And it was developing these t-shirts that we could then hand over to the players. And that happened within 12 hours, right? And so like also using like culture as a way in which we, and also our artist friends and our radio friends, to amplify our message is really important. Like I know we hit up one of our brothers, Ebro from Hot 97, and we tell him we gotta talk about the Raise the Age campaign, because 16-year-olds in New York State are being tried as adults, and that's something that the Correctional Association has been working on for years. But for us, it's really tapping into other sources, not just Twitter, not just Instagram, but also if we know some of these artists can amplify our message, it's also really key, because they're also telling it in a platform and using their platform, very similar to the civil rights movement, where you guys used a lot of these different artists to kind of amplify that was the work that was currently happening, because we all do great work, right? And sometimes we do it in silos, but it's a real opportunity for us to just continue to push the message out. And that's what we were able to do with Flint. I hit up Ebro at midnight, sent him an email, 6 a.m, he's on the radio, he's talking about there's a registry for the people of Flint, this is what's happening in Flint. Next thing you know, we have $25,000 of donations worth supplies for the people of Flint who have been suffering. And so I think for us, it's just using different means and making sure that we are able to control the message as well.
$25,000 worth of newspapers. Can you imagine?
Of supplies.
No, I'm saying suppose we had to sell that many newspapers to raise $25,000.
One thing on Twitter, because I'm a big fan of Twitter, and partly because it saves my marriage, because otherwise in the morning I'm ranting at what's going on, and Susie says to me, use your tweets. So that's good. But the reason I really love it is to talk about taking back the narrative. When the Stanley Nelson film about the Panthers was on PBS, there was a Twitter conversation going on internationally where people were saying things like, you know, we're watching the murder of Fred Hampton, and people are saying they murdered him in his bed, my God. People were learning, and then other people were responding to them. It was like a conversation. And so it wasn't about controlling the media so much. It was about controlling the media from a collective organizing kind of community. And I think that in all of the stuff that we've been talking about, there's a process that goes on that's about building a different kind of concept of what people can do. It's about building a revolutionary vision in practice, where people are not just saying, okay, let's get this story into the newspaper, but are creating culture and creating communication to do that in a way that's much more horizontal than just, you know, saying, oh, look, we got an editorial into the New York Times or something like that, which is also good because, you know, it influences other people. But so I'm not saying it very well, but it's something I'm learning more from your generation, even though I don't know Instagram yet. But I like
but I think
it.
We're
Twitter
also
is more than just things that people say. It's conversations.
And it's also tapping into different audiences, right? So some folks aren't necessarily reading the news every day. We get our messages from Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or Periscope. So it also allows you to tap into multiple audiences that maybe don't have access to mainstream media.
Anybody else want to add something before I switch?
Yeah, I also think the way that we've been able to use social media to raise funds for illegal funds, right? To actually let people know that people have been taken away while engaging in direct action. And so that being a critical piece where, again, when you're talking about people who have history of people being disappeared, the fact that we can know real time that this person has been arrested at this point, please everybody mobilize to call this particular precinct to respond, to show up, let's raise funds. So also being able to engage the state that way has been extremely effective.
And just one more thing, sorry. And to also build solidarity, right? We saw that with Ferguson when Palestinians were sending messages to those that were in Ferguson who were being pepper sprayed. And so it also allows you to build solidarity outside of your community, your city, and your state, and even your country.
Interesting, very interesting. Okay, we're going to shift a bit. I'm going to start with you, Jamal. So Jamal, you have recently produced an amazing film called Chapter and Verse. And I'm not going to tell the audience what it's about because you're going to share what it's about. And I know, Kathleen, you're writing your memoirs. And I know, Laura, you were in a film. We could talk about the movie. It's called The Weather Underground. But these are all cultural expressions in one manner or another. And starting with you, Jamal, I want to know why. Tell the audience a little bit about Chapter and Verse and why did you think it was important to do, and so that the audience knows ahead of time, when we finish the Q&A, we're going to watch a clip from Chapter and Verse, and we're also going to watch a clip from a video that Carmen provided that shows some of the work of the Justice League. So back to you, Jamal. Why did you do Chapter and Verse, and tell us a little bit about what it's focuses on.
Chapter and Verse is an independently produced feature film. And Daniel Beatty, who stars in the film, and I both live in Harlem. And we wanted to do something about our community, which is, Bill de Blasio talked about a tale of, you know, two cities, but there's a tale of two Harlems. And so you have brownstones that are now selling, you know, north of, you know, $4 million across the street from tenements where children are growing up in poverty. On the block where we live, in the neighborhood where we live, there are condominiums selling for $1 million literally across the street, around the corner and across the street from housing projects. And one particular project has not one, but 13 different gangs. And it's that zip code. One of the five zip codes that we talk about in New York State where, you know, the majority of black and brown bodies are coming from, young men. So when we walk down the street, we experience that duality. We see both worlds. We realize that every black man that we pass is what I call the third man. You know, the statistic that says that one in three black boys or brown boys in Harlem may one in eight may wind up in college, but one in three is guaranteed to go to prison. And Daniel is a Yale alum. I'm a full professor at Columbia University, but even sitting in that room, we realized that we were sitting with the third man. albeit for being, you know, a political prisoner, a prisoner of war. I'm the third man in my family in terms of someone who spent close to 10 years in prison, and Daniel's father and older brother have spent most of their lives in prison. So the story is about a black man coming home from prison, a former gang leader, after 8 years, and trying to rebuild his life, and the sacrifices that he has to make to consider what he has to do in terms of giving up his second chance at life so that a young man that he winds up mentoring can have a first chance.
Thank you, Jamal. Kathleen, why are you writing your memoirs? I mean, we all want to read them, but I know it's a labor of love. We've been talking about it for a while, so why
did you? Listen, I've been writing this book probably longer than half the people in the audience have lived. But that's because I keep shifting and improving and setting it aside, and also raising kids and teaching and trying to make a living. So I have written, in the third version, about 27 chapters. I've thrown out 6. I'm about to wrap it up. It's called Memories of Love and War. The time frame, not that I write about all this period, is from 1954 to 1984. And what happened in 1954 to 1984, the whole world basically changed. 54 is when the Brown decision was reached in the United States Supreme Court. But 54 is also when the Vietnamese won their independence. This was the third attempt, and they finally won it, and the United States began then trying to sabotage Vietnam. And so that was my connection. When this world changed, in America and in Asia and in the third world, the world was revolutionized. And so I began talking at that period of time, taking it through the 60s into the 70s, because it's a, how would I put this? A story that happens in the United States, in North Africa, and in Europe, and then back to the United States through the vehicle of my experiences growing up, going to college, quitting college, joining the Black Panthers, joining SNCC, I'm sorry. Never got a chance to join the Black Panthers. I got recruited and married. But I never had a chance to actually join. And being involved in a revolutionary struggle inside the United States and outside the United States that was brewing internationally. It was actually phenomenal to know that there were people in Cuba, there were people in Zimbabwe, there were people in Vietnam, there were people in Germany, there were people in North Africa, there were people in New York City, there were people in Oakland, all fighting against what we called imperialism or racism. And we tried, in particular, in California, we could have closer ties with Mexicans and closer ties with Cuba than in maybe Algeria, where Eldridge and I ended up living. Algeria was a independent state. The president was the leader of what they call the non-aligned nations. So the Black Panther Party and the government of Algeria were working together, you might say, while the United States was barred from functioning because of their participation in the Six-Day War, which many of you here are much too younger to know what the Six-Day War was, but one of the many wars in which Egypt lost territory to Israel. But so the book is a story of one person, my story, set in a world context that's radicalized this country and also helped generate a reaction to that radicalization that's made this country much more, to use a bad word, fascistic.
Okay. Laura, you want to comment on the film, The Weather Underground?
So, when I was about to be released from prison, I agreed, some people came in and visited me, and they said they were making a documentary about The Weather Underground, and I agreed to be in it for a couple of reasons. One was that while I was locked up, I was writing and reading and, you know, communicating, and I noticed that what had been sort of a revolutionary impulse that we had had in our generation about ending white supremacy by making a revolution and overthrowing the state and all that stuff we talked about had become unlearning racism workshops and sort of, no, really, and I mean, I think they're probably good things to you know, for white people to be told what we do that is obnoxious and arrogant and racist. But the bottom had fallen out in a way. And black people were still rebelling and resisting. There was the Simi Valley verdict about after Rodney King. There were a lot of things going on, but for me, white people were not responding in that same way. And so I said, well, I want to be part of this because that's what I want to say about the Weather Underground. The reason I joined it was that they had a position that there could be world revolution and that white people had a role to play in solidarity and that that began with the oppressed nations inside the United States, the black nation, Native Americans, Latinos, Mexicans, Puerto Ricans. And so I wanted to tell that story. I thought the film would tell that story. And I also thought that it would tell some of my reality, which is the reason I had joined the Weather Underground as opposed to some of the other groups that arose from the Students for a Democratic Society in the 60s, was that Weather, when I joined it, was primarily focused on solidarity with the Black Panthers. And so I thought it was going to tell that story. And I was very disappointed that it didn't because I felt that, and I really like the guys who made it. They're very nice guys. But they wanted to make a mainstream movie. So they interviewed people who would say the most sort of, you know, things about orgies and this and that was totally unimportant and bury the lead. So I was, that's why I didn't want to talk about them. And the other reason I agreed to do it was that I wanted people to know that there were still political prisoners in prison. I wanted people who would say, wow, that was groovy, people running in the streets, people doing this and that, to know that right now, still, there are people who are doing time. And that if we don't organize as we're organizing against mass incarceration and to abolish and change and throw out the prison system and replace it with something humane and something that builds communities and that actually deals with damage, not just the damage from crime and from fights, but the damage from the system on communities, and that communities do that themselves, like what Jamal was talking about the Breakfast for Children program was an example of that in the beginning, that if we forget the political prisoners, few, but in for 43, 44, 50 years, then we are a movement with no teeth and a movement that doesn't recognize our own history, all of us, and doesn't stand up for the people who've fallen by the wayside. So I agreed to be in the movie to do all those things, and it didn't do them. So I was very disappointed, but there it is.
So another movie must be made. Jamal?
Thank you, Laura.
So I'm looking out in the audience for my timekeeper. How are we doing? That looks like a two. Okay.
A two what?
Oh, that means we have 2 minutes.
No. Okay.
No, 2 minutes before we go to Q&A.
There you go.
Okay. So this is a question for anybody on the panel who wants to take it on. You know, one of the things that we have learned through our political histories is that history does have a way of repeating itself. And issues of police brutality, unarmed black and brown men being killed in the street, horrific conditions inside the prisons, corruption inside politics, we continue to be destroying the earth. There's just everything that was a problem, war, I mean, I guess the U.S. is probably in as many wars or more wars than it was in the 60s and 70s currently, although there are declared wars. So there was a lot of organizing then and now around the same issues. And at the same time back in the 60s and 70s, what we didn't know what was going on, but we learned later on, was about COINTELPRO and a very targeted effort on the part of the state to destroy leadership and destroy movements that were challenging the established order. And for Monica and Carmen, who are on the front lines now, and Laura, Kathleen, and Jamal, and myself to some extent, who are playing, I'll say, a supportive role, how can you challenge and protect yourselves from the same kinds of efforts? Because if COINTELPRO existed then, I think it's probably reasonable to assume that there's something analogous going on now, even if we don't know what we call it. So any one of my five wonderful panelists, take a stab at that question.
No, go, please. Go ahead, Monica.
Oh, good, they're fighting over the mic, I love it.
Well, what we know, well, just in New York City alone, the amount of surveillance of the NYPD is prolific, and it has expanded in a way that we have not seen in, ever before on, in the history of the United States. So the access to technology is actually working in behalf of the state and how they use it, how data is collected through every Facebook, like every shopping, online shopping that we're doing, and then to bring into the political sphere any conversations that are happening. So just to be straight up in front of, and upfront about it, that we are under constant surveillance, and we know as activists, our homes are broken into, our families are harassed, family members who might have any connection to the immigration process and getting any level of status here in the U.S. In the United States are being harassed as well. We're being confronted with it very upfront and centered in that space. And I don't ever walk with the assumption that I'm going to be protected. So that's like my first line of defense, right? That I am not expecting protection from the state ever. I'm expecting the state to interrupt, to dismantle, to break up relationships. And so the way that we choose, one of the many ways that we choose to counter that is to center our relationships, particularly in the group that I organize with. We always go back to, do we know each other? Are we connected to each other? What vision are we connected to? What is the political framework around which we are organizing so that when anything, if anything should go awry or if people try to infiltrate, we know our own people, we know our own tribe, we know our own community, and we can spot that out. But really anchoring back into relationships. And then doing things that are, in some senses, so transparent that there is nothing to hide, right? Just being like, we are coming for it when whatever the different ways are, being super transparent where we choose to be so that there's nothing to hide or nothing to get at. Also, not having this monolithic view of one charismatic leader or not allowing that narrative to be put on upon this particular movement, that there is no one singular leader, that we are a leaderful movement, as you've heard said. And so there are so many spaces to infiltrate that we're not going anywhere, right? We're not going anywhere. And then the training of leadership development so that it never becomes about me as an individual, but I represent a collective, and anybody could be sitting here, anybody could be responding. And so how do we create sustainable movements so that the movements just continue to evolve and not die? But I never walk with the sense of, I always am aware, whether I was in this movement or not, that I am being watched and profiled, whether I've, and our students are being watched and profiled in schools, right? We know that profiling starts very, very early.
Sister Monica really hit all of the points. She really did. One of the things is to remember the reason or question the reason why you're in the movement in the first place. And everybody said it in different ways. People use, you know, words like, you know, humanity, remember they're a human being. Understanding that, you know, if it was happening to, you know, as Sister Carmen said, you know, to a friend or somebody else in their community, even though the cuffs are not on me, I'm under arrest as well. In the Panther Party, we would say, and I always do this challenge when I'm talking, whether it's a large group or to some students. You know, as Kathleen mentioned, you know, we were a small organization, effective but small. But boy, when I go out, as many people that come up and tell me that their uncle, their grandfather, their auntie were Panthers, we would have had like a million members. But rather than throw anybody under the bus and blow up the spot, I say this to them. I said, ask them, what was the number one thing we learned in the Black Panther Party? Tell them not to talk about the 10-point program or the 26 rules of disciplines and all the stuff we studied from Malcolm to Marx and Mao. And every Panther will answer the question, will answer that question essentially this way. If there was one thing we were brainwashed, one thing we can remember as we are in our 50th year, they will say we were taught to have an undying love for the people. And the way we judge that was day to day, seeing what we call a brother or sister or comrade brother or sister, not listening to their words, but seeing their practice. So somebody out may be well studied, either because they had degrees from college or studied a lot in prison and can quote a lot of theory, And it would be that man or that woman, that brother or sister that weren't quite as articulate, weren't as well read, maybe had just learned to read in the Panther Party, but they were up at 4 o'clock in the morning every day to feed those kids. And then from there to a welfare center to work with the mothers. And then from there to a building that was being taken over. And then when they were exhausted patrolling the street at night, and let me tell you that when you get up in the morning and it's freezing cold in your apartment, because we didn't have special Panther condos with the heat, you know. Our apartments were, we didn't have the heat and rats were running around too. To get up and to travel across town to feed 50 kids or 100 kids that weren't your kids. And when you're exhausted at night, to get out that car, get off that bus, because you see cops with somebody against the wall with guns drawn, with somebody who's not your brother or your sister or your friend, but you get off the bus anyway because you understand that you're connected. That's not hatred. That's not egotism, that's love. Now, here's the thing about knowing who you're working with. Their consistency must show up. If they're there every day, and this is why we can use all the new tools to reach people, but at a certain point, it's about being in the room and doing that work, all right? Because you can fake an orgasm, yeah? But you can't fake the love, right? Because it's a one-off, right?
Oh, that's quite so an analogy, good. Jamal.
But if you're really committed, if you're really committed, it's a day-in, day-out struggle. We all know in terms of raising kids, a long marriage, that's day-in, day-out work. So we have to judge that work, and that's really, really important. And that's how we begin to, and lastly, this is real important. Just because you have a device that says you can say anything, you shouldn't say everything. As a defense lawyer told me when I was a young Panther, don't say anything on the telephone, in the Panther office, or in a speech that you don't want to hear repeated in court. But we think social media gives us permission to say anything, to have the arguments, and back on that idea of love, I challenge this audience to do something that Sister Sonia Sanchez always talks about when she speaks. She says, I'm going to give you one of the toughest assignments you can imagine. She says, and you may think it's about organizing, you may think it's about, you know, fasting and protest or boycotting. She says, but I'm challenging you to go 1 week without saying a bad word about anybody, because that's what our movement is based on.
I wanted to talk about that for a second.
Oh. I just have one comment. There was a woman, somebody here, if you're old enough, might know Ellen Cooper Jackson. She edited Freedom Ways. Anyway, she and my mother and James Jackson all grew up together. And I'm quoting her when I say, it's a protracted struggle. And it will continue.
I just want to bring the voice of Safiyah Bukhari, who's another late comrade who was a member of the Panthers and did time in prison, and then when she got out spent all of her energy until she died really young working to free political prisoners. And she wrote a lot about COINTELPRO in her papers. And what she talked about was something really simple. If you have a beef with someone, talk it out. And it's not saying something bad about the person, but it's also talking to people and working out differences. And I think one thing that's really instructive to me about the younger generation movement is that there's a variety of political positions that people have and still work together. And we were a lot more like, you know, you follow the line or else you're out. And I remember, some people in this audience will remember this, that some of us, we were doing something called the John Brown Anti-Klan Committee for years. It was good work. But we couldn't unite with white people who talked about ending racism because we believed, and I do, that it's white supremacy, it's not racism. Okay, fine, what the, you know, I mean, really? So that kind of like, how many angels can dance on the head of a mimeograph machine? You gotta be able to like, embrace, you know, sort of see where, look at the heart of what people in the practice, what people are trying to do, rather than, you know, what are your differences. So I think it's real important. So Safiyah talked about people's courts. They had one a people's court in the late days of the Panthers where she had a beef with someone and they actually had, you know, people held a discussion in a court and worked it out. I don't know if it's, you know, she tells the story. I don't know if it was as good in practice as it sounded, but some ways of working out those differences, because that's really opened us up to a lot of agents, because they come in and they say, hey, I know you really got a beef with so-and-so, and I'm going to tell you what she said about you, and then, you know, and it just builds. It's very hard to counter that without some kind of honesty.
I will say, I just kind of, I love the fact that I'm the youngest of five, and I have such a intergenerational family, because it's a reflection of the work that I do now working for Mr. Belafonte. But for me, it's really about thinking before you talk, right? And in the six principles of nonviolence, one of the principles is attack the forces of evil, not people doing evil. And we're also taught suspend your first judgment. And I think a lot of times, even as activists, we create all these, we want freedom and we want liberation, yet we create all these barriers on how we can actually work with one another. And I think that's something that I see very different from the work that I've done with young people who are incarcerated and men that are incarcerated. They're not creating all these barriers. Oh, well, she's not from New York, so I can't work with her. She's a woman, I can't work with her. I think what happens oftentimes in the movement particularly is that because we have different tactics, or maybe we're not centered on the same ideology or methodology, we then create these conflicts that are not really real. And so I love the fact that you're talking about, you know, talk to the source and try to resolve it, but that doesn't necessarily happen. I think that's where we get caught up on this Twitter battle. But also personally, I know there was a situation that happened in one of our meetings where 3 hours of our meeting was discussing this individual who's an elder. And for me, I was like, well, he's not my oppressor, he's not my target, you know, we're trying to, you know, dismantle the system. And I was really conflicted because it actually kept going and there was this intergenerational divide happening. So I went to Mr. B and I said, hey, Mr. B, like, I know you didn't like everybody in the movement, but you got along, right? You were constantly connected, you kept your eyes on the prize. And how can I do that? Because sometimes I could get caught up in my feelings. And he said something so profound that took me really out of my feelings. And he said, those that are working for the liberation of our people are only subject to support and friendship. Those that are being divisive are playing the enemy's game. And that's really the way in which I try to operate, because it's really easy to say, well, I'm not really aligned with, you know, we marched from New York City to DC with three criminal justice reform bills to highlight and elevate the individuals that had been killed by police brutality. And we called on our generation allies to come and support us. People were like, we don't march anymore. We don't do that. We don't care about marching. But it wasn't about the marching, because we were going to march. There's 100 of us that were committed to 250 miles. What we wanted was the support of our generation to show up for us the way in which we showed up for them. And so I sometimes feel that we, you know, back in the day, it was very, you could see what was happening in regards to COINTELPRO, right? Sometimes we can't even see it because it's our own people that sell us out. And so I just kind of wanted to say that, because I think what we're missing even in this movement now is, yes, it's a leaderful movement and it's beautiful and it's committed to the elevation of the most marginalized, is that we still need to figure out a way in which we really talk to one another, we really build with one another. And I see that's where the opportunity is, because we are committed to the liberation of each other and our people. But I did want to highlight is that sometimes we get into these, even the word beef, because, you know, some of us come from the streets. Beef is very different on the streets than it is in the movement. Like, you could go to Twitter and start some beef, but if you come to the streets, it's some real stuff going down. So we got to keep it a buck and, like, also try to, you know, not use the language that we use in the streets onto this, like, radical movement ideology or space, because it means two completely different things. So I just wanted to say that.
Okay. So we have some time for some questions now. We only have one mic. That's intentional. So those of you who've heard me moderate panels before, you've already heard this, but I'm going to remind those of you who might have forgotten, because grammar school is a long time ago, questions end in question marks. Okay. So if you have a statement, something profound, Elizabeth Sackler opened up, talk to her. You can see about being on States of Denial next year. But today, we're taking questions and we'll have answers from the panelists. And please state your questions succinctly because we want to give ample opportunity for a number of people to pose questions, and then we'll hear from the panelists, and then we're going to watch those two video clips that we spoke about. First question, sir.
What is the role of oppressed people's economic power and the use of the same in affecting social change?
Anybody want to take that on?
Real quick, one of the most effective things is, and I'm just having a conversation with someone about this, is boycott. You know, it was an effective tool in the anti-apartheid struggle. Columbia University, and this is not covered widely enough, but students and faculty at Columbia pressuring the administration. A few months ago, President Bollinger sent an email announcing that the Board of Trustees at Columbia University is divesting from any their portfolio from any company doing business with prisons.
This is credit for that.
But it's a model that, you know, it's a model that it's something that students can really get into, you know, in terms of their campuses and their schools, just to say, this happened at Columbia, we want it to happen there. So, yeah, people can, you know, we from the Montgomery bus boycott to other things, when people understand that their dollars mean something and that those solidarity dollars mean something, it can really be an effective tool.
You know, I'm
and also, reinvestment back into... black business is also important. So if you're going to withdraw, I know we've done Black Friday, all these different things, but also reinvesting and knowing that, you know, you should go back and invest in black businesses.
You know, I'm reminded, and I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, today is March 20th. Today would have been my father's 94th birthday. Oh. And the reason I bring him up, other than, of course, he was very dear to my heart, is as I was a young activist and I thought that I knew everything and I had an afro that required me to turn sideways to get into the front door. And, you know, I would shout Black Power as loud as I could as he was saying we should say grace over Sunday dinner. He would say to me, you know, the only power that really matters is green power. And I hated hearing him say that. Okay. But the reality was, we're selling newspapers to raise money, right? You're on asking radio personalities to help raise money. We have Kickstarter and all these other, we'll get back to that, Laura. We'll talk about Kickstarter later. There's other online ways to raise money. But there was something that mattered about having some green power if we were going to achieve any other kind of power. And so I just want to lift up that reality, and I think it ties into the question that was just posed. Next question.
I'm sorry, I came here late. So I didn't hear if you had spoken about culture as much as you've spoken about, you know, the movement. I was in IWK, which was Ibo Akun, which was the sister organization to the Young Lords back in the 70s. And we moved on from there, got into culture, and I did a show on the Black-Asian relationship back in the early 90s and tried to collect a great deal of historical information about this, since my father had a laundry in the middle of the Black community. And we were able to collect a lot, but I couldn't get any funding to do it. I couldn't continue. I had a professor down in Virginia who was ready, an African-American professor who was ready to collect all the information we wanted to gather. I couldn't get any support to show, you know, all of the, that I know personally in my own life, the relationship between Blacks and Asians. Now that relationship has transformed. It's gone to another level, particularly in more recent times and in the riots that was in LA. I'm really interested in continuing to collect that information, but I'd really like to hear, perhaps you can speak to this, the relationship that our two communities have.
Well, I will say, first of all, to my brother from Iwakun, which stands for the Harmonious Fists, power to the people. And I have to, whenever this comes up, you know, we have to invoke the name of Yuri Kuchiyama. And Sister Yuri was lived in Harlem. Sister Yuri was Japanese, lived in Harlem, raised her children in Harlem, and was a force in the liberation movement, a force in the movement to free all political prisoners and prisoners of war. So you're right, and I think those stories have to be told, and we should talk afterwards so that it's captured, that people can see it, that people can hear it. It is really about being griots. And if we could turn to the culture aspect of what we do, I consider myself an artivist and a griot, someone that combines arts and activism. And the griot was the storyteller in Africa who sat in the center of the village, usually underneath the big tree called the baobab tree. And he or she had the responsibility of, you know, talking about the history and the current state of the tribe, but they also had to be entertaining. They needed to do both, right? So if you were like a good griot and, you know, knew all of the history, but you were boring, people would be like, man, I'm going to the next town because I'm not ready to take a nap, that griot. But if you were a griot that was like really, really entertaining, but your facts were wrong, they'd call you out. They'd be like, man, I was on that hunt. The griot's, you know, beating that drum, talking about that hunt, talking about, talking about Abdul killed that lion. It was his little sister, Keisha. I was there, you know. So in that spirit, it's our duty to tell these stories, but also to put the human face on it. As someone who teaches arts and culture to my students, it's not just people, our young people, our communities will look at a film or play or listen to a song also because it's good. And the best way to make it good is if we can personalize these stories. And a lot of times I think even as activists telling stories, we think we have to talk about the ideology or the movement. But if you get a small story about someone who first transformed their life and then dedicated their life to transformation or something that was amazing, people will kind of latch onto that to do that. So let's figure out how to tell that story and so that people are reposting those stories, sending people to the link to do it. To me, that's the way to do it. It's just to continue to tell the story and to tell it in an exciting way that people want to repeat the story.
And just to add, one of the things that we did in 2005 when we were first founded by Mr. B is that he took delegations, he took young people from all different walks of life to different communities. We went to Epps, Alabama to learn about the African American struggle. We went to California to learn about the Latino Chicano struggle, and then the Onondaga Nation, Orange County for the Asian Pacific Islander struggle, as well as the poor white in Appalachia, to find our interconnectedness and really build a national movement that was grounded in culture, spirituality, and nonviolent. And that was something that, I mean, what he did for so many of us was so profound. And I wish that funding would be available so that we could continue to build that movement and build that collective strength and power. But unfortunately, people don't want that. Right, so we have to find other means to get the Kickstarter campaign to really build relationships, and it was really based on music, it was based on culture, and it was based on storytelling. To like be in Appalachia with poor white folks and dancing to folk music was like something I've never done in my life, and it was just so beautiful to have that cultural exchange. But even currently right now in the work that we do with the gathering inside detention centers, we use art, music, film as a tool for transformation, bringing in documentaries from the different movements so that young people could really own their own story and find themselves and see something greater for themselves than what they're giving in public schools. So I just wanted to say that.
Monica, do you want to add? Okay. So listen, we have a long line for questions, but we are going to show the video clip. So what I'm going to ask each person to do is succinctly, that means short, state your question, and then we're going to hear all the questions, and then the panelists can pick and choose what they're going to answer, but we're going to do all of that in about 6 minutes. Go for it, Jamila.
All right. What's up, Sophia? So really quickly, first, thank you for acknowledging the Columbia struggle, because something that we've been doing all over the city. So CUNY and the New School are all doing the prison divestment stuff. So thank you for bringing that up. My second thing is in terms of white supremacy. So something that's really huge right now is people doing like these trainings on anti-white white, not anti-white, sorry about that, but anti-racism. Could you speak more to that in terms of what that looks like? Because it's so huge right now and honestly really problematic, and I don't think people understand why it is. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next question.
Hi, family.
Hey, Shani.
So
I don't know everybody here. Okay, bye-bye.
For those of you who don't know, my name is Shani Jamila. I'm an artist and cultural worker. And one of the things that really roots my work is this idea of expanding our collective political imagination, that you can't fight for a better world if you can't even imagine what it looks like. And so I guess I want to hear you riff a little bit on this idea of the role of imagination in our work. Thanks.
Thank you. Next question.
How are you doing? Coming from a former inner city gang member perspective for myself, there's a lot going on. I'm going to make this brief. I know we have limited time, but there's a lot going on out there within people in this conscious community, right? It's like they separate themselves from the community nowadays, whether people see it or not. Now it's like, but back then it was like, if you was conscious, you was conscious, you know? Nowadays it's like, it's a conscious community, and then they raise the hood, you know? That's a big problem. So like, which way are you directing? So like, which way would you direct the people to go? Because we can sit here and talk about this, you know, which is great. We need to have these discussions. But if the people are not directed towards doing something, it'll be in vain. That's all.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to say that I'm really happy to be here. I'm really happy to learn from all of you up here. And I think that all of you have done amazing work in your years of doing this and all of your experience. So thank you for being here and for the young people who are in the room who are learning from you all. My name is Tanisha Morrison. I work at the Correctional Association. I am a youth justice advocate.
I thought I recognized you.
Yes. So my question is, what would you say to young people who are interested in doing this work and how to engage other young people around history and the culture of this movement and how to pretty much get young people on board with what is going on now and just engaging them and getting them to learn about what's going on, the connection between what happened in our past and what's happening now and how important it is. So,
okay. Yeah. Thank you. Next question.
Good afternoon. My question mostly is for the two Panthers, but in general, one element of the Black Panther Party was the element of self-defense. And given the level of police repression and police brutality and police murder, it was like an upfront out there in the community, we're going to take a stand to stop the police and monitor them in terms of the murder and the brutality. And I wanted to know how folks felt about, is there a relevance or a need, or what role can that play today in dealing with police brutality and murder?
Okay, thank you.
Do you believe that that's a form of struggle we need to wage?
Okay, thanks. Next question.
Hey, family. Around, when we look at a movement that's so full of young leadership now, Carmen, I know you talked about Mr. B and how he's played that mentor role with you. Can we talk about what the role of active involvement can be for elders in the movement, especially when we talk about issues like political prisoners that still exist?
Okay, thank you. Next question.
Isn't it most important to ensure that we all vote? Our families vote, our friends vote, and get out the vote. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. Next question.
Question to Jamal and to Kathleen. Can you say anything about Beyoncé's performance? And if you can, also the new Black Panther Party.
Yes, I'll do that.
Okay. What? How are we time-wise? Where's my timekeeper? It's tight.
So.
Well, the thing is, actually, we... No. So
we
here's
have
what we're going to do.
Anti-racism, collective imagination, consciousness in the hood, versus the hood. How do we engage young people, history and culture? There was a self-defense question about the Black Panther Party and elders in the movement. Anybody? And Beyonce.
I don't think we left anything out. Okay, so listen. From my panelists, Each of you can take one of those and give a quick response, but just one. So only
I'd like to do a quick one to about collective imagination.
Okay.
So what we do in a program that I run, Impact, I worked at a place called City Kids. Sister Amelia Otto was here. She does something called Otto Brand Artivism. It's the idea to get young people in a space and give them the skills and see them imagining themselves in a different way. So first of all, we create this thing called safe space, because young people are coming from, you know, being physically abused, being bullied, being told they're not good enough, you know, hearing that they're bitches and niggers and whatever you can imagine, and freeing them up to understand that they are safe to be who they are, safe to imagine and to dream. And when they begin to imagine themselves differently, they can imagine the world differently and imagine themselves as agent of change. So that power of storytelling and that power of understanding that their stories can make a difference first in their lives and in the world is so important. And so I'm a big, big advocate and active worker in empowering young people through the creative arts, not just to put on a play for a play's sake, but to see themselves and their world as a different place. And then what actions can you take toward that, just beyond just performing, but to do things in your daily lives?
Okay. I can take on the youth question.
Carmen, you're going to take on the youth question? Go ahead.
So I often kind of see myself as the bridge between youth and elders, art and institutions and all these different things. But for me, my love is for young people and working with young people, particularly that are incarcerated. And a lot of the work that we try to do is to bring in the best of the best into the detention centers or youth prisons so that young people can also have access to this different level of consciousness. I can't see the brother who asked the question, but I will say that the work that we do and the people that are in our space are directly impacted by the issue. The individuals that are in our space are formerly incarcerated, are also artists, are also former gang members. And so those are the people that are going back into the community to make sure that the young people are coming into the space we are, or we gotta go back into the hood. So it's not mutually exclusive. It could be both, right? I think there doesn't need to be a conscious person and it doesn't need to be somebody who's unconscious. I think it's just really about opening the door for opportunity, because I come from the hood. I also was one of those young people that was told this was gonna happen to you, but there was an individual that believed in me, and that was my basketball coach, Pat Bell. He believed in me and all my sisters that I grew up with on the court, and he provided that opportunity. And I feel like those of us that know the hood also should continue to stay in the hood and also be in other places to open the door. And I will say, in regards to like youth development, and I'm down to also speak to this further, because we're running out of time, but I will say that, you know, we're always looking for somebody else to save us, and I think we're the ones we've been waiting for.
Yes. Okay. I'll speak to, there's like a thread for a couple of them, and I know you're gonna speak to art, okay.
There was an anti-racism question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, I'll try to do it real fast. So what I was saying about the unlearning racism is that it is white people's problem on an individual level, but changing it is a systemic issue. It's not about being a nicer person or not saying or taking seriously when someone says to you, you know, don't use the word beef and like act like you're from the street. It's like, you know, in prison I learned that when I said, oh, I had a fight with my friend, my friends thought that I meant that we beat each other up. You know, in my family, fighting was yelling. It was a different kind of a thing. It was just, and so being aware of the things that are about privilege, how it works, very important. But if you don't do something to fight to change it, then it's meaningless. And so, you know, when I say this, I know there's someone in the audience that we're going to do some conversations about Jewish identity and what does it mean to have a Jewish identity. And I always say, the only time I identify as a Jew is when I speak out about Israel, because I don't want them acting in my name. And I have a responsibility, and I get a pass because people don't think I'm anti-Semitic. They just say I'm self-hating. But so it's and then if I don't try to build BDS, boycott, divest, and sanctions, then I'm just doing the same thing. So to me, it's a matter of whether you're doing something in solidarity and action, or whether you're just saying, hey, I'm a good white person, and I don't use bad words. And that to me is it. And on the elders thing, there's a lot that, you know, I think that we need to be answering questions that younger people have. And we need not to be thinking that we know what they should be doing. And so I said before to Monica and Carmen, people my age, sometimes we should just get out of the way and not start telling you about, oh, well, in our day, we did it this way and that way, until you want to know something and from us. And other than that, I think it's basically about just being willing to answer the questions and tell the truth about what we did, and not what was done to us in different, like in, when people talk about their organizations, a lot of times we want to talk about what someone else did to us, or what, but what we did, the mistakes that we made, and to try to be honest about it. And sometimes being honest about it means that you push us about it, and then we come across with the real deal.
Most of the things have been responded to, but just in direct connection to this. So I have a long history with the People's Institute for Survival and Beyond, which is a grassroots community organization based in New Orleans that does anti-racism and community organizing trainings. And what often gets left off is the community organizing piece, right? And so how do we, if we're not doing any type of effective dismantling white supremacy, whatever all of these spaces are called, and it's not connected to community organizing, then it's just conversation, right? And so the tactic of these workshops used to be, and I'm not saying this is not what this institute is doing, but what we see happening now was to actually collectivize and bring activists together, create a political framework, and then move from outside of that. What that piece is not so much happening. You're seeing people coming, feeling a particular way, getting, oh, okay, I can now be friends with everybody, but never taking that level of action. And so when I think about all of these themes, I'm also thinking about the space in which the healing from internalized racial oppression that has to happen as part of these movement spaces. What does it look like for people of color to heal from the messages of internalized inferiority, and what is the work of white people to heal from and change that your connection to internalized racial superiority? I cannot imagine use my collective imagination or be futuristic if my day-to-day is really rooted in denial of my own self, actual real life systemic conditions about being able to feed family, are my children getting profiled in schools, and then what I internalize. So while there's the systemic aspects that we're addressing, I also know that there's the healing from the internalized messages that keep perpetuating all of these dynamics that we see movement generation to generation. And I think that's the space where elders, there's always space for elders. I've done 20 years, my model of organizing is through rites of passage, which is rooted in the history of the elders informing young people, and that it's a multi-directional relationship. It's not ageist. It is collecting on the wisdom of our elders and sharing the passion and energy, creativity, brilliance, and leadership of young people. And so there's always space, and we have to make sure that the work of our elders is centered so that, and we talked about this a little bit earlier, so that we are actually seeing ourselves as part of a continuum and not as a starting point. And then we won't have to keep restarting in 10 years when the next thing happens.
Right, thank you. I think Kathleen said she would take on the Beyoncé question.
And self-defense. I'll start out with self-defense. Okay. Black Panther Party for Self-Defense was the name of the organization that began. It later just became known as Black Panther Party. And I want to say something about self-defense coming out of the South. Self-defense is our core culture. Mm-hmm. We have to defend ourselves culturally. We have to defend ourselves educationally. We have to defend ourselves with weapons. They may not always been used, but where I grew up in Alabama and in many other families, there was always a shotgun, and there was some revolvers also in the drawers. You were taught how to shoot. You were taught how to pay attention. We would hear, I don't remember ever seeing, but we would hear the Klan's gonna march, and everybody would get ready.
You hear that now.
But, so the, to politicize it and take it to the urban areas, to the West Coast, to the New York, et cetera, it became a different phenomenon, but that's the core, and it's still the core of any self-respecting, self-defending community that's going to survive in this racist, economically dominating, cultural wasteland of America.
Did you leave anything out?
Yeah, it's a great country. Now back to Beyoncé. I happened to be on an airplane going back to Atlanta when the Super Bowl was taking place. So very fortunately, I was not offended by this Super Bowl pastime, or what do you call it, halftime show. And then when I saw it, I was somewhat flabbergasted. And the person who asked me about it sent me the video, and I said, it's almost pornographic. And she said, you don't watch too many music videos, do you? I said, no, I don't. But what bothered me is I've talked to a lot of Black Panther women. Now, I'll tell you, the Black Panther men said they liked it. That was cool. So the Black Panther women I've heard from, we did not wear any fishnet stocking, shake our booty, and wear Tams. I mean, that was just absurd. It's about something else. It's about completely something else that's promoting something else, that's using those images for some other purpose. And I think it's very offensive myself. But because of Beyoncé's worldwide popularity and the Super Bowl's worldwide popularity, I just figured, just leave it alone. Why bother? Why bother? But it's clearly nothing in any way, shape, or form representative of Black Panthers. It's taking the imagery that has been popularized by a group that was popular because it stood up against racism and police brutality, and taking that strength and attributing it to something as commercial and as insignificant as a music video or a halftime show, although the former mayor, we used to call him Giuliani. Remember all the demonstrations? We had posters against Giuliani? Well, the fact that Giuliani got upset about it, I kind of like that part.
One quick thing, I promise this will be in a minute. To our organizers, and just connecting just a couple of dots, if we're just organizing outside of the community and not around people's needs, then it just becomes that something people see on TV or on Facebook or on Instagram. We have, you know, lofty ideals to people who are struggling every day. We talk about freedom and liberation and justice. Freedom to somebody who is hungry, and we're dealing with poverty, and especially children in poverty. It's epidemic proportions. Freedom to someone who is hungry is a meal, folks. Liberation to someone who is homeless is a safe, dry, warm place to sleep. And what we understood, standing on the shoulders of the civil rights movement to the liberation movement, is you have to go and organize people around your needs. And that's why when the police surrounded Panther officers and other Panthers couldn't get there, the community came out. They may not have agreed with everything in the 10-point program, but they understood that these kids are feeding my kids. I went and got blood pressure medicine when the hospital turned me away. You may call them criminals and terrorists. Those are my brothers and sisters, and the grandmothers will say, my babies. So I'm putting my body in front of these bullets for these Panthers. Last quick point, and I attribute it to Joyce Joseph, who always reminds me that there is no start date on activism and no expiration date on dreams. So let us fight that fight.
Excellent. Okay. So just before we turn on the two videos, and I hope that you'll watch them, and remember the panelists will be available afterwards because I know you're going to have more questions. You'll see them off the stage. Please join me in thanking them for engaging in this amazing conversation this afternoon.